Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to today's professional lunch at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. I'm Anthony Rowley, First Vice President of the club, and it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Before I do so, I'll also say that on my extreme right is Ken Moritsugu, who is the Bureau Chief of Associated Press and also a member of the Professional Activities Committee, which organized today's event. Well, it's a great pleasure to welcome back Dr. Paul Sheard, who is Chief Global Economist and Head of Global Economics and Research for S&P Global. I say welcome back because he's spoken here at least three or four times before. I can't remember exactly how many, but it's nice to have you back. And I think his visit could hardly be more timely. What's being referred to very often nowadays as Trumponomics has already trumped Abenomics when it comes to grabbing headlines around the world, I think. I recently moderated a round table of economic and investment experts for my newspaper, the Singapore Business Times, and we were privileged and very happy to have Paul as one of our panelists. And I think the message that came out of that discussion was that if ever there was a time for investors to fasten their seatbelts, this is it. The road ahead, these people said, will be bumpy and full of unexpected twists and turns. Mr. Trump's arrival, advent, some said, could light the fires of inflation, send interest rates soaring, put an end to secular stagnation in the global economy, trigger fiscal stimulus, and bring large-scale infrastructure investment back into fashion. But there are also negatives, they said, which could include a possible bond market crash, economic overheating, a resurgence of protectionism, currency market turbulence, and other upsets. So today we have the opportunity to hear it firsthand, or from the horse's mouth, if you like, what Trumponomics could really mean, and also Abenomics. Paul is an expert on the Japanese economy, too, and on Abenomics, and so he'll be talking about fiscal aspects of that and also Bank of Japan policy. You've got a brief biography of Dr. Sheard on your notices of today's event, so I'll say only that apart from leading teams of economic experts and analysts within the S&P group, he served in the past as chief economist at Nomura Securities in New York and also at Lehman Brothers in New York and Tokyo, as well as being a member of the World Economic Forum Global Agenda Council. Dr. Sheard also has an impressive academic record, having been formerly on the faculty of the Australian National University, ANU, and at Osaka University. He was also a visiting researcher at Stanford University and at the Bank of Japan. So with that, I'm going to hand over to Dr. Sheard. May I remind you, by the way, please put on your KTIM mobile phones onto manner mode or switch them off as a courtesy to our guest. So please join me in welcoming Paul Sheard.
Great, thank you. Thank you very much, Anthony, for that very warm welcome. And it is a great pleasure to be back here at the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan for another one of these professional lunches. I'm not exactly sure when we discuss Trumponomics whether you're hearing from the horse's mouth, but I'll do my very best. Certainly, it has been a very interesting year and few months. I'm based in New York. I've been there now for 10 years, so have been watching the election process, the presidential primaries, and the presidential election campaign fairly close up, and getting a little bit more educated on all of the intricacies of the U.S. political system, which is very complicated indeed. But certainly, Mr. Trump's victory, everybody is recognizing, was certainly a rather unlikely event, appeared to be unlikely. He beat off 16 other candidates or opponents in the Republican primary and then took on Hillary Clinton, who many people had thought would become the first female president of the United States. And I think he's also quite unique in not having any political experience, military experience. And so this is really the first time, particularly, probably I think first time ever, but maybe definitely first time in modern times, where somebody has moved from the business world into the White House and is taking charge of the administration. It's been interesting to observe the surprise that people purported to have with the election of Mr. Trump. Certainly the polls were showing a Clinton victory. Various websites that do kind of statistical analysis were predicting various odds, which, you know, in some cases were, you know, 75% chance of a Clinton victory or only a 25% chance of a Trump victory, and some of them showed less, maybe more like 10%. But it was down to two candidates, and even a 1 in 4 chance, you know, comes up pretty frequently if you toss the coin a few times. So in retrospect, I don't think we should be as surprised about the victory as we apparently collectively have been. But I think it was just, again, this unlikeliness of somebody like Mr. Trump actually winning the presidency that has caught people off guard. But in retrospect, when you look at this now, you know, it, I think, has become a little bit clearer that this was very much an election where there was a very clear choice given to the electorates, a choice between largely a continuation of the status quo versus a real opportunity to change and try something different. And Mr. Trump really won because he swept the industrial heartland, states like Pennsylvania, Ohio, Michigan, and even more unlikely, Wisconsin. And also, of course, took the all-important state of Florida. So, you know, clearly, on balance, people, United States voters, of which I am not one of them, I hasten to say, being an Australian citizen, I don't vote in the U.S., I don't have that privilege, but clearly enough people decided, let's have a change, let's do something a little bit different for a change. So what are the implications of this? Well, one immediate implication, and this is something that that I was flagging, you know, earlier as I was talking to people about the upcoming election, is that, of course, now we have a clean sweep of the White House and the Congress when it comes to the Republican Party. So we have Republican Congress, House of Representatives majority, Senate majority, and also a White House in Republican hands. If Hillary Clinton had won, it would almost certainly still have been a divided government, that is, Democrat White House with at least one of the houses, the House of Representatives, in Republican hands. It was very difficult to conceive that there would have been a Democrat clean sweep. So I think that really is one important sort of difference, just to really understand up front, that now there is at least the opportunity that a lot of the policies that were talked about, you know, will actually be put into effect. One my little footnote there, though, I think we interesting to note that the Republican majority in the Senate is, of course, very, very slim, razor thin, 51 or 52 seats to 48 or 49. And it's worth just remembering that 4 of those 16 opponents that Mr. Trump defeated are actually sitting senators, Senator Cruz, Rubio, Lindsey Graham, and Rand Paul in Kent, from Kentucky. So, you know, it would not take too many senators who tend to be a little bit more independent-minded to assert their independence for some of the Trump policies to be blocked in the Senate. So that's worth just keeping in mind. Shouldn't get too carried away with the idea that the Republicans now have a clean sweep and everything will go through. The other, sort of just reflecting on this comment, one thing that sort of occurred to me was the parallels of the Trump victory with Brexit. And I actually happened to be in Tokyo in the end of June. I think I spoke here at that time, but on the day of Brexit. And again, that was another big surprise. But there's a parallel here to Brexit in the sense, in terms of the structure of the problem, so to speak, which is that while Brexit and also this election were binary choices, one was really a choice to stick with the status quo. Now, I call a Clinton victory would have been largely status quo, in the sense that it was pretty clear what kind of policies Mrs. Clinton was proposing, and it's pretty clear that there would have been a divided government. So probably there would have been a large amount of continued gridlock in Washington. And so dramatic things would have been unlikely to have gotten done. Whereas, on the other hand, the choice of Mr. Trump is really a kind of leap into the dark of uncertainty. I think anybody who at this point, even before the full cabinet has been announced, that would stand up and with a high degree of confidence tell you this is going to happen and that is going to happen, I think would be overconfident and talking their book a little bit too much. There is a huge amount of uncertainty here about what kind of president will Mr. Trump develop into. What kind of policies will he really prioritize and try to push through? What kind of policies will he be able to get through the Republican Congress? And what will his style be as a president? Will he be sort of more visionary, kind of big picture, or will he be quite engaged in the details of policy? He's not particularly known as a policy wonk, but will he develop that kind of engagement in policy? So there's all sorts of possibilities here. And I think you could paint a picture, by and large, of some very relatively good outcomes and also some rather not so good outcomes, some bad outcomes. In terms of so I think the distribution of possible outcomes is quite bimodal rather than a normal kind of distribution, which it might have been under a Clinton administration. Taken at face value, the economic policies of Mr. Trump, President-elect Trump, appear to be fairly or quite pro-business, pro-growth policies, tax cuts, tax reform. People have been talking about tax reform in the U.S. for years. It's really never developed much legs. There is an opportunity now for that to happen. There's a lot of emphasis, I'm sure as you know, on rolling back what is perceived or is characterized as excessive regulation that is choking the American business. So big focus on deregulation. Part of that is rolling back and replacing Obamacare. We'll have to see what shape that takes. Part of it also is focused on rolling back elements of Dodd-Frank financial reform. Part of it is also focused on energy reform and other reforms on business. And then, of course, we have this emphasis on a large infrastructure program, a multi-year infrastructure program. And also, throw into the mix, a commitment to beef up the U.S. Defense spending as well. So it really adds up to quite a stimulatory fiscal policy as well as a deregulation policy. Obviously, there are some serious risks here as well, and what people most worry about, of course, is Mr. Trump's policies on the trade front. Already, of course, he has come out to reaffirm his election, one of the planks of his election campaign, that he is opposed to TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership. Something, of course, which is very dear to the hearts of Japanese, and having lived in Japan and only left in 2006, it was very clear that Japanese were all over TPP many years before anybody in the US, other than a few trade negotiators, knew what it was. But TPP became part of the election campaign, and Mr. Trump has indicated that from day one he intends to withdraw from that. We'll have to see how that all plays out over time. And certainly for the moment, TPP would appear to be dead in the water, but one never knows. I think the simple point I would make there is, when it comes to TPP, this is really something that was hopefully going to change, which now will not change. So it's not a change to the status quo per se. It just means that something that was expected to happen is not going to happen, at least in its current form. But there's also talk, of course, of renegotiating some of the existing trade deals that are in place, NAFTA being the most important one, and also talk about levying tariffs. I think here we'll just have to wait and see how this all plays out. And it's not really clear at the moment to what extent a lot of this trade or sort of anti-trade protectionist sounding rhetoric really reflects firmly held principles or a worldview that Mr. Trump has, as opposed to rhetoric that was important for winning those industrial heartland states and which can be backed away from, or which really represents a kind of bargaining position, tough bargaining talk to get a more leverage in deals with trade partners. We'll just have to wait and see how that plays out. But that seems to be, I think, in most people's minds, the key downside risk. And of course, you know, echoing back to the 1930s, Smoot Hawley, tariffs and protectionism, that would not be something, obviously, that would be good for the global economy. But assuming that there would be no trade, we don't really go down that path. It stays more at the rhetorical level. As I said, I think the key message of Trumponomics, if that's what it's been called, now is this sort of shift to very expansionary fiscal policy. And I think that's quite interesting, because in the markets, among the economics fraternity in the last several months and years, there's been a number of debates going on, and one of them has been around this idea of secular stagnation. This is something that Larry Summers sort of kicked off in November 2013, and he's continued to talk about this idea of secular stagnation. And the idea of secular stagnation is really to say that what is called the natural rate of interest, that is the real rate of interest that is associated with the economy being at full employment, is negative or at least very, very low. And that's essentially why central banks like the Fed are having to keep their policy rates very close to zero, because this natural or real rate of interest is actually negative or very, very low. And that comes from the idea that there's essentially, or the hypothesis is, that there's too much savings relative to investment. And there's a debate about how permanent is that, how secular is that. And therefore, there's been a good deal of skepticism. A couple of things have followed from that. One is skepticism about whether the Federal Reserve, in particular, not to mention other central banks like the Bank of Japan or the ECB or the Bank of England now, would be able to raise interest rates and get those interest rates back anywhere near sort of normal levels. And there's also, parallel to that, been a lot of debate about the policy mix. Here we've had the last 7 or 8 years since the financial crisis and since the Great Recession, when there's been an inordinate burden placed on monetary policy, and fiscal policy has not really been mobilized to stimulate economies very much. And a lot of economists have been arguing that really, and Larry Summers has been at the head of the list, but many economists have been arguing, with this apparent excess of savings over investment, and lack of investment in the private sector, and an abundance of savings in the private sector, this would be a very good time for governments to engage in more fiscal expansion, and particular infrastructure spending. Essentially, governments around the world, the US included, have been able to borrow to finance infrastructure investments at negative real rates over 10-year or even longer horizons. And anybody who visits the US and comes through JFK or LaGuardia Airport or LAX, doesn't need very much convincing that there is some creaky infrastructure. So this has been a debate in the economics profession and in the markets. And stepping back from the politics of this Trump victory and some of the obviously divisive rhetoric and controversial aspects, the policy mix is very much saying, okay, we do need infrastructure investment. There is more room for the government to borrow. And all of this should provide space for the Federal Reserve to start to raise interest rates a little bit faster. Now, if you look at the Fed, coming into this year, the Fed was signaling through its so-called dot plot that it was expecting to be able to hike interest rates 4 times this year. Well, we're still waiting for the first interest rate hike. It's almost certain it will happen in a couple of weeks' time, in mid-December. But we will get 1 rate hike this year rather than the expected or the signaled 4 rate hikes. So there's been a lot of skepticism in the markets that the Fed would really ever be able to raise interest rates in the way that they had been signaling. That may all change. The US economy is getting close to full employment. It's not quite there yet. There's a debate about how much slack is still left in the labor market. Some measures, such as a broader measure of unemployment called the U6 measure, which measures not just headline unemployment, but people who are working part-time that would like to work full-time, and people who have dropped out of the labor force but have indicated if the jobs were there, they would come back into the labor force. That measure of unemployment is still a couple of percentage points above where it was pre-crisis. So there's certainly room, if the economy starts to be stimulated with fiscal policy, tax cuts, infrastructure investment, and maybe animal spirits coming back into the business sector, for people to be drawn back into the labor market, and also for part-time workers to work full-time, if not overtime. And also the participation rate has also fallen dramatically in recent years, and there's scope for that to come up. So the Fed itself, up until now, had been adopting a stance of essentially signaling that they were prepared to get behind the curve with monetary policy to try to see where the speed limit of the economy was and maybe push the economy to that speed limit, over that speed limit, and perhaps see if the economy overheated a little bit and then play catch up with monetary policy. And that was largely because fiscal policy was not really doing very much to stimulate the economy. If fiscal policy starts to stimulate the economy in a much more a robust way, then we do have the real scope now for the Federal Reserve to have to start to normalize monetary policy. At the moment, we think probably there'll be 2 rate hikes next year, but it could be 3, and in 2018, probably another 3 rate hikes. So this is a sort of a, in some sense, could be a long overdue rebalancing of the policy mix away from too much reliance on monetary policy, so-called central banks being the only game in town, as Mohammed El-Erian has called it, to fiscal policy taking a bigger seat at the table. Now, one thing that is very unknown at the moment, and markets will be watching very closely, is what will the attitude and the approach of the new administration and President Trump be to the Federal Reserve. There are 2 governor positions vacant on the Board of Governors of the Federal Reserve, people who have not been appointed. Mr. Trump now will have the opportunity to appoint 2 new governors. And one of those governors is also a vice chairman for financial stability and financial oversight, which that position came out of the Dodd-Frank legislation and has never been filled. Governor Tarullo is kind of doing it on a de facto basis, but that's an important position that's never been filled. And of course, Janet Yellen, position as a Federal Reserve chair, is up in February 2018. Around about the time that Mr. Kuroda comes up as well. So there'll be 2 major central bank governors coming up for reappointment or replacement. And that will give Mr. Trump, at the latest in 15 months' time or so, 16 months' time, the opportunity to put his imprint on the Federal Reserve. And so a lot of focus here will be on what sort of approach does he take. Will he and the new Republican administration continue to respect the independence of the Fed, or will perhaps there be some reversion to earlier periods of time, maybe the 1970s, where the feeling was that the Fed was a little bit more subservient, if you like, to the overall government policy. So this is an interesting thing that we're just going to have to watch and wait and see. And it does come against a backdrop, I think, where looking at policy over the last few years, there's been a growing feeling, and I've certainly made these arguments in some of my comments that I've made, that the paradigm of sort of a very strict separation of fiscal and monetary policy, and fiscal policy being not playing as big a role anymore in macro policy stabilization, and fiscal policy being seen very much as the preserve of politicians, and monetary policy being given the prime responsibility for managing the economy, so not the politicians, but rather the technocrats, the economists at the central banks, really having the prime job of managing the macro economy and doing so in a very technocratic, independent way. That paradigm has not, which it worked very well in the old inflationary days, but there is a very a growing debate that changes need to be made, fundamental changes need to be made to the way we think about and operationalize that paradigm of macroeconomic policy management. And so we don't want to throw the independent central bank baby out with the bathwater here necessarily, but I do think that these changes that are happening in the US are coming against a very interesting backdrop where maybe it is time to revisit some of these frameworks and see if they can be improved as well. Now that brings me maybe just to say a word about the Bank of Japan in closing. I think I've got 5 or 10 minutes left if I are still in Anthony's good graces here. So let me just talk a little bit about the Bank of Japan and what's going on here. Now, of course, the big event since I was here last time in June was the September 21st decision of the Bank of Japan to change its framework again to now QQE with yield curve control, following this important so-called comprehensive assessment of the QQE program to date, which was QQE and then QQE with negative interest rates. And this was obviously a very important development. And I think the backdrop here was, concern in some quarters that QQE was not working, that maybe the time had come to revisit it and maybe even abandon it in some shape or form. There was also concern that the negative interest rate policy experiment in January of this year had kind of backfired on the Bank of Japan. Normally, and of course the Bank of Japan did not pioneer negative interest rate policy. The Bank of Japan has pioneered many non-conventional policies, quantitative easing, credit easing, forward guidance. These are all policies that are now well known to central banks that were pioneered by the Bank of Japan. So, hats off to the Bank of Japan for being innovative. They didn't pioneer negative interest rates. Negative interest rates were pioneered in Europe by the Swiss National Bank, and then Swedish Riksbank, Danish Central Bank, and then in June 2014, most notably, the ECB adopted negative interest rate policy. So the Bank of Japan was able to kind of learn from that and copy what was done in Europe. But normally, one would expect, with that kind of policy, and certainly the ECB had this very much in mind, that introducing negative interest rates on overnight deposits at the Reserve Bank, at the central bank, would put downward pressure on the exchange rate. And yet in Japan, it had the opposite effect. So there was a sense that this was backfiring. And of course, as you would know better than even myself, there was a lot of criticism and angst from the financial institutions, the financial world, about the compression of the yield curve. And in fact, the yield curve in Japan inverted in negative territory. Overnight rates being minus 10 basis points, and then 10-year JGBs were yielding minus 20 basis points. So a truly extraordinary outcome there, which again I think was flowing into and feeding into this comprehensive assessment. Now, this was very much in the markets, keenly anticipated event to see what the Bank of Japan would come out with. And many commentators and observers thought that maybe this was all a kind of a camouflage for backing away from quantitative easing, that the Bank of Japan was having second thoughts, maybe getting wobbly knees, and were just wanting to change course. As it turned out, I don't think that was the outcome. The outcome, as you know, were really two new innovations. One was to move to this yield curve control. And this is, again, something that in modern times, at least, the Bank of Japan can claim credit for pioneering, now targeting not just the overnight interest rate, but also a point, the 10-year point on the yield curve, which is pretty unprecedented. The Fed did something like this back in the Second World War for about 9 years, but since then it's really been unheard of. And then secondly, this commitment to overshoot the inflation target of 2%. And the commitment there is for the Bank of Japan to continue to expand its balance sheet until inflation goes above 2% and stays there for a period of time, actually overshoots. So I think this is an interesting development. There has been, again, a lot of debate about this in the markets and maybe some confusion. One of the points of contention is, how can a central bank target both the quantity and the price, if you like? That is, not just determining the amount of reserves that are being created or the expansion of monetary base, but also at the same time target a point on the yield curve, 10-year point. Well, the answer to that is, well, they can't, actually. And really what the Bank of Japan is doing is to put primacy on the yield curve, and the amount of reserves and the way that those reserves are provided to the banking system, in a sense, becomes a free-floating variable. Although they are indicating that, you know, over certain short-term horizons, their expectation to continue at a certain rate. But that really becomes a flexible variable rather than a very fixed variable. But I think if you look into the framework, it has a lot of flexibility in it, and maybe it's a little bit overcomplicated, but I think is an interesting new development. When you step back, though, from what the Bank of Japan is doing, I think it's another interesting way to think about this, at least I find this interesting, is that it's almost as if, and the Bank of Japan is not saying this, but it's almost as if they're acting on the premise, the following kind of premise, that there are two big macroeconomic problems in Japan. You could add to this list, but two ones that have exercised a lot of attention is, of course, this ongoing deflation. And the second one is the mounting government debt burden. And I think the Bank of Japan implicitly through this framework is sort of saying, well, really only one of those problems should be what you worry about. In other words, one of those problems should be solvable. And so essentially think of it this way. The Bank of Japan is saying, we'll continue to expand the balance sheet. We will continue to buy JGBs. And we're going to continue to do that until we have achieved our inflation target. Now, logically, the outcome of that should be one of two things. Either somewhere along the path of continually expanding the balance sheet by buying JGBs, there will be a shift in inflation expectations in the Japanese public, and that will start to translate into inflation, 2%, eventually 2% inflation. So in that case, at some point in the future, deflation would disappear, so the deflation problem would be solved, and the amount of government debt securities in the hands of the public would be much less than if the Bank of Japan had never done all this QE. But that problem would still be there, but deflation would be solved. But it could be, as some people believe, that QE will never be able to solve deflation, or at least get inflation up to 2%. Now, if you believe that, then you would also essentially be saying that the Bank of Japan could buy up all of the JGBs in existence and continue to finance the total annual government deficit in Japan and not, as a result, trigger deflation, then essentially the fiscal problem, the debt problem, has disappeared because there is no debt left in the hands of the public. That's a sort of a reductio ad absurdum argument. But I think logically, and there may be some other problems, well, what happens if the bond market disappears and everything else? But just looking at those two problems of deflation and the debt problem, it would seem to be the case that the program that the Bank of Japan has in place is implicitly saying, ultimately, we should only have to worry about one of those problems, not both of the problems. Now, again, you won't find the Bank of Japan talking in those terms. Central bankers don't like to talk about essentially refinancing or monetizing government debt and budget deficits. But logically, I think that's kind of the path that we're on. So I remain, you know, fairly upbeat, I guess, or supportive of what the Bank of Japan is doing. But I think there are two things that need to happen or need to continue to happen. One is that what you would not want to see is another round of fiscal tightening. The way to overcome deflation, in my view, is to have monetary and fiscal policy both cooperating and pushing in the same direction to achieve the objective. What we've seen time and time again in Japan is prematurely the fiscal brakes being put on, pushing the economy back into recession, and therefore making it harder to change the public's inflation expectations. Now, the good news there is that there's no consumption tax hike until October 2019. But the bad news is the clock is ticking on that date, and we're now below 3 years. And if it turns out that it is going to take longer and longer for the Bank of Japan to achieve its objectives, at some point we get closer and closer to another fiscal tightening, and that will presumably make it more difficult or be an obstacle to the Japanese public changing their expectations about the future path of inflation. So that's something that is a bit of a worry. The second thing that needs to happen is that the Bank of Japan does need to stay the course, to continue on this path. If they blink, then of course the situation will change. And there, of course, the concern is that the time is running out for Mr. Kuroda. Mr. Kuroda is clearly very much associated with this policy, and of course, he now only has something like 15, 16 months of his tenure left. And the Japanese public has seen in the past, when the governor has changed, there is a potential for radical change in policy at the Bank of Japan. Now, I think the radical change in March and April 2013 was in a positive direction. But if you're trying to manage the public's inflation expectations, it's very important that the public believe that the central bank will continue to operate its policies and send the same message. And so I think the change in the governorship in 2018 is another looming sort of risk for Japan. So I think it's quite important that the government and the Bank of Japan somehow reassure the public that nothing is going to change when Mr. Kuroda steps aside at that point. That's, of course, maybe challenging and difficult, but I think that problem needs to be addressed in some shape or form. So let me stop there and very much look forward to the questions from the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Very incisive, as usual, and only 5 minutes over deadline. Right, questions from the working press first. Perhaps I could just begin with a question, if I may, which is the initial reaction since Trump was elected in the markets has been for money to rush out of emerging markets into the dollar. The dollar is strengthening quite strongly as a result. Equity markets are going up. How long can this continue for, this trend of a rising dollar and, if you like, a bull market in equities?
Yeah, that's a very good point, Anthony. Of course, if you look at the market's reaction, I mean, again, if you live in the U.S. and if you're watching cable TV, the so-called talking heads, it's pretty much 24/7 talking heads, and they're still going. And every day there's more and more commentary about what's going on. But it's interesting to ask the markets, what do the markets think? And the markets have given at least an initial fairly clear message, which is they do see one way or another, at least as an initial assessment, this change in the holding of the reins of the White House towards the Republicans as being pro-growth. And we've seen the equity markets move up, not that dramatically, but certainly move up and reaching new highs on the Dow Jones, for example. We've seen the dollar strengthening against other currencies. And of course, we've seen interest rates move up, particularly 10-year treasuries have moved up from around about, I think, 1.7 to 2.4 now. So there's been a big move up. And so the question is, how long could that continue? Well, yeah, I think a lot of things can happen. That was really part of the point I was making, Anthony, that I don't think you can be at all dogmatic about these things. It will all depend now on what kind of policies are put in place. It will partly depend on, again, as if we do find that, that fiscal policy and monetary policy, now the Fed may start to raise interest rates, but it will do that relatively gradually. And so there is a possibility that they do get behind the curve. And one of the things we're going to find out pretty soon, or at least probably during the course of 2017, certainly by 2018, is how much slack is there in the US economy. That is, some people think the U.S. economy is already pretty much at full employment. Others think, no, that's just what it looks like. There's actually a lot more slack there. And will the policies that the Trump administration and the Congress come out with also shift the dial or start to shift the dial on potential growth? Potential growth meaning what is the growth rate when the economy is at its full employment, full capacity level. And, you know, one thing we saw in Japan in the 1990s and 2000s was after the bubble burst, the potential growth rate in Japan continued to come down and down and down. You know, largely driven by demographics, but also due to other factors as well. And that has started to be the pattern in the US as well. Most people have started to bring down their estimates of potential growth in the US. Now many people would say, it's more like maybe 1.5 to 2%, whereas in the old days you might have said at least 2.5%. Some people thought even higher. So that's, I think, going to be one of the questions here. Can any of these policies, deregulation, and particularly reform of the tax system, getting a more sensible tax system in place, could that start to unleash investment, which then feeds into a higher potential growth rate in the future? So I think the initial verdict of the markets is very kind of positive. But you do highlight in your question, Anthony, one question is, Mr. Trump wants to bring jobs back to the U.S. He wants to bring manufacturing jobs back to the U.S. How are you going to do that if the effect of your policies is actually to strengthen the dollar? And again, we're going to have interesting kind of debates looming here, because during the campaign, Mr. Trump said many things, and one of the things, and many of those things will probably be washed away, but one of the things he said was that the Fed was keeping interest rates low artificially to somehow help the Obama administration, which sort of implies that he would like to see the Fed raise interest rates. But if you have a strong dollar and then the Fed does raise interest rates several times, which would kind of reinforce that currency move as well, it'll be very interesting to see whether he changes his tune and puts pressure on the Fed to go a little bit slower. So a lot of uncertainties here, but I think from the market's point of view, pretty unambiguous thumbs up in terms of growth.
Okay. Questions from the working press first? All right, just very quickly, one more question, then I promise this is the last one from me. You said surplus of savings in the private sector, deficit of investment. That's true, of course. And thus room for fiscal space for. But that implies that governments are going to have to go further into debt at a time when the bond market is looking increasingly unattractive. Isn't there something wrong there?
I'm not sure if the premise of the bond market looking unattractive, and again, it sort of depends a little bit where you're talking. So if you take the US at the moment, 10-year Treasury yields were, before Mr. Trump was elected, around about 1.7%. The Fed has an inflation target of 2%. That essentially means that the markets were saying the US government could borrow on a 10-year basis at a negative real rate. If you believe that many infrastructure projects are there that would be capable of yielding positive social rates of return, that would seem to provide a pretty strong argument that the government really should be borrowing more to invest in infrastructure. Now, of course, nothing stays still for too long in this world, and the moment when it looked like now actually that's what the government might do, guess what happens? Interest rates move up. So now with inflation, with 10-year treasury yields at around about 2.4%, and the Fed's inflation target of being 2%, and they're not missing that by very, very much at the moment. Real yields, if you like, or real borrowing costs for the government would be more like, let's say, 0.5%. But that's still a pretty low hurdle to tackle. If you look elsewhere, of course, if you look in Japan, again, come back to the Bank of Japan, the Bank of Japan is essentially saying, at least for the time being, we will have a 0 10-year nominal rate. And we'll sort of commit, we're not quite commit to that rate actually, but at least that's the existing rate. And why are we doing that? Because we are determined to achieve 2% inflation. That's essentially saying at the moment the Japanese government can borrow at minus 2% on a 10-year basis. And in some sense, why wouldn't you do that? Now, of course, if the government avails itself of that opportunity, that will then, of course, be noticed by the markets, and the interest rate won't be zero anymore. There'll be upward pressure. And then the Bank of Japan would be in the happy position of sort of recalibrating its yield target to accommodate that upward pressure on interest rates. And if we go to the ECB and Europe, again, you see a very similar picture where the unemployment is still very high in Europe, in the Eurozone in particular, it's above 10%. The level of real GDP is only just got back to and surpassed by about 1% or so its peak level from 2008. Borrowing costs, again, are very, very low in many of these economies. So that really is the argument for pushing the envelope a little bit more on fiscal policy.
Stefano Carreff, the Italian Economy Daily newspaper. Do you forecast that the Federal Reserve will raise very soon interest rate? And if so, do you think that for the BOJ will be easy to keep the rates around zero? No, because I mean, many observers think that from next year it will be not easy for the BOJ to buy such an amount of Japanese bonds or to increase the purchases because of the tight liquidity that is already surfacing in the market. And the second question, if I may, on the short term in the market, some observers think that the outcome of the referendum of next Sunday in Italy could have some impact on even on the global market through Europe. How do you see this factor on the short term for the market? Thanks.
Oh, great. Well, thanks, Stefano. There are three good questions there. So will the Fed raise interest rates very soon? I mean, I think I said this morning on Bloomberg that it was certain. I usually wouldn't say that. No economist wants to say anything is certain. But I said, unless there is a major shock between now and 2 weeks' time to the U.S. economy, it's virtually certain. So yes, there will almost certainly the Fed will raise interest rates at its December meeting. That will be the first time it has raised its interest rates for a year. If you look at the FOMC minutes from the November 2nd meeting, nobody thought the Fed would raise interest rates at that meeting because it was just a few days before the election. And while the Fed would say, well, that really doesn't really make any difference, the reality is that they were going to take a pass on that meeting. But if you look at the minutes of that meeting, it's very clear that if there hadn't been an election coming in a week's time, they would have been ready to make that adjustment then. Subsequently, the numbers look fine. They just had an upward revision of third quarter GDP. So it's almost certain that they'll raise interest rates. What will be interesting, what Fed watchers will be looking at at that December meeting will be the so-called summary of economic projections, and particularly what they call the dot plot, which is where the once a quarter, FOMC participants update their forecasts for GDP, for inflation, unemployment, but most notably for their own estimate of what they think the appropriate level of the federal funds rate will be over the next, actually, 2018, 17, 18, 19, and even over the longer term. And as a result of this political change and policy shift, how does that shift the Fed's own thinking? We've been talking today about what we think, you know, this means. It means that the Fed should be able to raise interest rates and perhaps do more interest rate hikes over the next few years than the market has been anticipating, simply because fiscal policy is tightening the economy and really forcing their hand. Do they reflect that in their own forecasts or not? That will be something to watch for. In terms of the Bank of Japan, first of all, talked about the September shift. You know, it wasn't a great market response to those policies, but of course there has been a fairly dramatic market reaction to the Trump victory, and it's a kind of gift to Mr. Kuroda, with, again, equity markets continuing to do quite well in Japan, but most notably the exchange rate falling. I think today was 114 or so. So that's, I think, is really moving the exchange rate in a direction which makes it easier for the Bank of Japan to achieve its objectives, and also, of course, the upward pressure on yields. So the zero target for the 10-year yield is not obviously a pinpoint. They're allowing a little bit of a deviation, but until the U.S. election, the Bank of Japan was falling short of zero, so it was slightly negative. Since the election, it's been overshooting a little bit, two or three basis points on the upside. So I think that's the happy position for the Bank of Japan to be in. They want their policy to succeed. What would success look like? It would look like upward pressure on long-term interest rates as inflation prospects start to improve and growth prospects start to improve. And then the Bank of Japan can decide, what do you do about that? So as there's upward pressure on that zero 10-year nominal yield, they've got two things they could do. They could counter it by actually buying more JGBs and pushing bond prices up and therefore putting downward pressure on yields. Or they could say, okay, there's upward pressure on yields. We're going to accommodate some of that by now targeting a slightly higher 10-year interest rate. Maybe they lift that to 10 basis points or 15 basis points. That's almost like the first tiny baby steps of an exit strategy. But so I think they've got, Stefano, quite a bit of sort of flexibility here in how they manage things. And I think there's still a lot of JGBs out there to be bought. So I don't think that they're going to run out of JGBs anytime soon. And of course, one of the other things that they changed in September was to abandon the target, the maturity target, which was, I think, something like 8 to 12 years. Now they don't have a maturity target, so they have a lot more flexibility. Average maturity of the JGB portfolio that they hold, they have a lot more flexibility now in whether they buy long term or short term or anywhere in between. So they can kind of do twist operations as well as outright JGB purchases. So I think I don't think there's too much of a concern. The Italian referendum on Sunday will be extremely interesting to watch. This has been so the referendum is, for those of you that don't follow Italy all that closely, is a referendum on constitutional change that Prime Minister Renzi has invested a lot in, essentially to change the sort of the structure of the Senate in particular and make it ostensibly easier for the seat of government in the lower house to push reforms and legislation through. So it's a sort of a constitutional change, but it's turned into a kind of referendum on Renzi, and it's turned into a kind of a referendum on Italy's place in the Eurozone and the European Union. And the polls seem to be suggesting that it will be a no vote. And Mr. Renzi has indicated that if he loses the referendum, he will most likely resign. And so there is a lot of nervousness in the market at the moment. if that's going to happen, and could that sort of, you know, we just had Brexit in June, now we had Mr. Renzi, who, young, sort of rather rather telegenic, kind of somewhat flamboyant prime minister, reformist, if he goes the way, he's a little bit like, some sense, a little bit like, well, he's younger than Abe, but, think of him as a little bit of a Italian version, you might think. If he stumbles and we go back to another prime minister, finding another prime minister, and political instability in Italy, Italy is the third largest economy in the Eurozone, and Italy's economic performance has been very, very poor in recent years. I mentioned the level of real GDP before. That number for the US is about 11%, 11.5% above. So GDP is now 11.5% above its pre-crisis peak in the US. That's pretty good. In the Eurozone as a whole, that number is just 1%. But in Italy, it's minus 8%. So, Italy is, in terms of its economic performance, is in the Eurozone at an exchange rate, if you like, now, which is proving very problematic for it to recover. And so any political instability with also concerns about weaknesses in the banking system, potentially, the concern would be that starts to reignite, the whole issue of the future of the Eurozone. And if that happens at the same time that Britain is about to pull the trigger on Article 50 to start to negotiate a withdrawal from the European Union, the whole situation starts to look very, very messy. So yes, this has been the year of surprises. Next year we have the Dutch election, French election, and German election, but this Italian referendum on Sunday, a lot of market participants will be holding their breath to see what the outcome of that is.
Okay, well, we'll open the floor to questions. Peter.
It's Peter Langan from Asia Times. I have two questions, if I may. The first one, you stressed there it's important that the BOJ stays the course. It's been said by a number of commentators that that's sort of a violation of the Einstein maximum defining madness. That is, you keep doing the same thing over and over again, expecting that the result will be different. So I'd like your comment on that. And secondly, if I may, I'd like to ask something sort of perhaps slightly off topic, but about your company itself. Glass-Steagall is history, and now we're talking about Dodd-Frank being rolled back. So there is the possibility of, forgive the expression, but the dogs of finance being released once again. Your company paid a $1.4 billion fine related to mispricing, or rather inflated ratings on mortgage bonds in the last financial crisis. I'm kind of interested as to what is S&P doing internally to perhaps prepare for that, or have you done anything, or do you see any dangers in that respect with the loss of Dodd-Frank? Thank you.
Thanks, Peter. You're right. I mean, you only want to stay the course if you think you are on the right course. And if you're on the wrong course and you just say, I'm going to stay the course, you're heading for disaster. So, implicit in that comment, of course, was my own view that, I think that monetary policy acting with fiscal policy, I would always make that qualification. I do think you need the two working together, can achieve the outcome of a 2% inflation rate, and I would also would join most of my economics fraternity in saying, well, a 2%, around about 2% inflation, is a healthy state for the macro economy. So I think that is a prize in Japan's case that's worth going for, but because Japan slipped into deflation in the 1990s, and basically the modern theory of how these things work is, to be very sort of simplistic about it, is the public's inflation expectations really drive inflation. And so if the public is expecting 2% inflation because the central bank tells them that's the central bank's target, and people have confidence that the central bank, you know, knows what it's doing, then you're in this happy situation of you have 2% inflation. The public doesn't second guess the central bank. But if you get stuck at, say, in expecting zero or, say, slightly minus inflation, and that gets embedded in the economy. And then on top of that, the central bank itself validates that, which is essentially what happened in Japan under Governor Shirakawa, where the Bank of Japan said, well, look, we have to live with this deflation. It's not something that monetary policy can cure. Then you will get this continued inflation expectations or deflationary expectations feeding into actual deflation and in a sort of a negative feedback loop. So I'm in the camp that says monetary and fiscal policy, if it's operated in the right way, can achieve an outcome of 2% inflation. But it's not that easy once you're stuck in deflation to do three things. One is dislodge the public's inflation expectations, then raise them, let's say 3 percentage points, and then re-anchor them. It's very, very difficult for reasons we probably don't have time to go into. So that's my sense of, yeah, I think it can be done, I think it should be done, but it requires the central bank and the government collectively regaining credibility with the public that they will be able to achieve 2% inflation. So in some sense, if you believe that, as I do, the worst thing in the world would be for the Bank of Japan and the government for that matter, because, you know, Kurodonomics, as I've called it, is very much, you know, part of Abenomics. The two go hand in hand. If, you know, the Bank of Japan would have thrown in the towel and say, you know what, we tried, but it didn't work, that would just be validating, again, the public's deflation expectations, and probably, I mean, next time round, it would just make it even that much harder. You had a second question on the rollback of Dodd-Frank, et cetera. Just very quickly, because I'm watching the clock here.
Don't worry, you can run over.
Okay. But just in case you wanted to take another question. Again, one of the uncertainties, Peter, is we don't know what the Trump administration and, of course, the Congress is going to do in terms of rolling back Dodd-Frank. I think there's a fairly strong sense in the U.S., certainly in the financial community, that, two things. One is definitely regulation was needed, and, you know, a lot of things needed to change after the crisis, and a lot of things did change. But perhaps the pendulum of regulation sort of swung too far, and the compliance costs became very, very heavy and very, very high. And maybe, you know, there is a debate within the regulatory community, particularly between, you know, people like, say, you know, the Bank of England and people like Andy Haldane, who's been notable in this area at the Bank of England, and the US side of saying, yeah, there are better ways to do financial regulation, a little bit more market friendly, a little bit more parsimonious. So, we'll have to see how that all plays out. But I think there is a legitimate concern and question that needs to be raised. I don't think anybody, well, most people would want to see a return to the pre-crisis situation where there was a sort of market fundamentalism, sort of an idea that markets were essentially self-regulating and regulation was bad. Now, I think it's all about finding the right kind and level of regulation. You did ask about a company that I work for, S&P Global, which contains S&P Global Ratings. We did make a settlement with the government that was, a settlement. Wasn't any, admission of what the charges were, but a settlement. But a point I would just make, which maybe is not known to many people, is like many financial institutions or institutions in the financial services area, rating agencies we became regulated in ways that we were not regulated before. So there's quite a heavy dose of regulation. I don't think that regulation is going away. We've made enormous investments in compliance, in new systems, etc. So, we're not, obviously going to walk away from any of that.
Okay, any final questions? But just before you have a question?
But go ahead.
Go ahead if you have a question. That's fine.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask, during the election campaign,
the market here in Tokyo seemed to swing quite a bit with the polls. When Trump went up in the polls, the market went down. When Clinton went up, the market went up. Obviously, after the election, things kind of went the other way. And I'm just sort of wondering what, how you would read that. Were the markets misreading what was happening? I mean, if I had a crystal ball, I would have bought, you know, before the election and made a killing afterwards.
We'll let the applied finance people trawl through all that data and test the with event studies and various other hypotheses. Maybe that was just, you know, ex ante. It was the uncertainty. The polls indicating that Trump was more likely, leading to a sense of uncertainty, and then a bit of a sell-off and, you know, risk off, as the term is used in the markets. Once it actually happened, then it became, you know, probability one. And then I think, you know, often what markets do is kind of like, you know, move on. And they almost press the reset button. And a lot of, you know, hedging positions. So before you have that resolution of uncertainty, there are a lot of things going on in the market, you know, including hedging, et cetera. Suddenly you have the result. All of those kind of hedges get taken off. We now know what the result was, and people start to look forward again. And I guess, came to the conclusion that this is, again, you know, pro-business, pro-growth. And again, the market term would be you're back in a risk on rather than risk off kind of mode. But I'm a humble economist, and you know, if I knew how to read markets better, I would probably not be doing the job that I'm doing.
Okay, well, it's time to wrap up. Unfortunately, you may be a humble economist, but I think you're a very astute economist in putting over your arguments. Thank you very much for stimulating debate. And you already have an honorary membership, but here is an extension of that honorary membership for 1 year. Thank you very much. Okay.